In most game settings, horses are a delightful sight for sore eyes. You can load them down with riches, take them into cities without pesky questions like, "Where did you get that owlbear?" or even ride nearly vertical slopes to reach the mountain peaks. But you're missing one crucial element. Flight. Welcome back to A Compendium of Monsters, it's Pegasus Week. Before we continue, pound that subscribe button with the power of 1,000 hooves! I'm not dramatic, just excitable. Pegasi are challenge level 2, and I can give you two reasons they're great. They won't attack you on sight, and they can fly with ludicrous speed. These large celestials have an armor class of 12, average hit points of 59, a speed of 60 feet, and a flying speed of 90 feet. For context, a flying speed of 90 feet is faster than most other creatures in Dungeons & Dragons. Even ancient dragons only have a flying speed of 80 feet. Pegasi can understand celestial, common, elvish, and sylvan, but because of their equine background, they're too busy horsing around to reply to your respectful queries.
Such disrespect.
With no resistances, immunities, or condition immunities, we head straight into actions. And by that, I mean action. Singular. Pegasi can make a single attack with their hooves and deal an average of 11 bludgeoning damage, which is fairly low for a challenge level 2 creature. To be honest, the damage is low because Pegasi aren't intended for combat. Their flying speed makes them almost impossible for most creatures to catch, and in Dungeons & Dragons, you gotta give a little to get a little. Born out of the Olympic glades of Arborea, Pegasi largely serve the Seldarine, known informally as the Pantheon of Elven Gods, which brings me to how Pegasi end up on the material plane. It is a sign that the Seldarine have chosen to intervene and aid their chosen heroes, because not just Red Bull gives you wings. Pegasi only willingly serve good-aligned, virtuous individuals, and while they can be persuaded to help an adventurer, it is exceptionally difficult. Despite their significant running speed, Pegasi spend little time on the ground by choice, and come on, if you could fly faster than you could walk, you'd fly everywhere too. Pegasi create roosts in hard-to-reach places where they share a nest with a mate that they live with for the duration of their lives. This seems problematic as Pegasi give birth to live young who might fall to their deaths, but what's a little natural selection between friends? Or maybe the foals can fly. Instructions unclear, threw foals to their deaths. Now, the burning question often in one's mind is, are a Pegasus's wings realistic? Should a Pegasus even fly? I mean, the average weight of a horse is somewhere between 700 and 1300 pounds, and the wing size required to achieve lift is presumably ridiculous. And we haven't even talked about the proper bone density and muscle structure to accommodate wings. To be honest, I don't feel like litigating this particular issue will accomplish any worthwhile conclusions. Dungeons & Dragons is a place where a myriad of ridiculous things are possible. If a teeny little plant smokes even a single Feoween, it turns into a sentient garbage heap intent on consuming everything it touches. Pegasi seem less ridiculous by comparison, even if their ability to potentially carry a very heavy adventurer on top of their own bulk, no less, is sketchy as f***. If regular Pegasi are boring, I'm happy to inform you that glass Pegasi are canon. Their stats are basically the same as a normal Pegasus, except for a few things. A change in armor class, and numerous condition immunities. Plus, then you have a glass horse thing that can fly! Don't tell me you wouldn't be the coolest kid on the block. I do find it strange that glass Pegasi don't have a vulnerability to bludgeoning damage. You know, being made of glass and all. Whatever, it's fine. DMs, this isn't a creature designed for combat unless you're running a game for a party of evil adventurers who plan to commit an unspeakable atrocity, which we'll talk about in just a second, but make sure to review the rules for mounted combat. A Pegasus treats its own kind and the Seldarine with respect and admiration, but is suspicious or even fearful of all others. With an intelligence score of 10, Pegasi are average. This does allow them to plan escape tactics, analyze threats, determine if a potential aggressor could be a friend, etc. If your players are hunting a Pegasus, they'll need help to gain an edge. Whether it's by demonic pact, devil contract, or literally capturing a Pegasus's foal, there's no way most adventuring groups can keep up with a flying speed of 90 feet. But like I mentioned above, if your player's characters are thoroughly evil, they can capture a Pegasus and turn it into a different kind of mount known as a nightmare. This process involves brutally torturing the Pegasus as its wings are slowly carved off of its body. This isn't enough to complete the transformation, so sprinkle in a little dark magic as if adding salt, and voila! A mount that only serves the epitome of evil. What is the exact magic used to transform a Pegasus into a nightmare? That's the fun part. You, as the DM, get to decide. I recommend you create a forbidden, ancient ritual site with corruptive traits that cause your player's characters to take damage or receive a form of madness for simply being in the area. Regardless of how easy or difficult you make the transformation ritual, be aware that the Seldarine and Dark Seldarine will absolutely take notice of such an act. Your player's characters might soon receive a group of visitors for all the wrong reasons. I'd probably run them off the material plane and into hiding either in the Nine Hells or the Abyss. Then you can drag Loth into it and watch the chaos ensue. Oh, if you're new and not sure who Loth is, she's the leader of the Dark Seltarine, of course. You may recognize her people, the murderous hentai-ish group of Dami mommies constantly jockeying for a taste of Senpai Loth's power. What a sentence! You can thank me later. Players! Pegasi are kind creatures that you should leave alone unless they're sent to help you. If you're evil and plan to turn a Pegasus into a nightmare to serve your own purposes, go for it. I don't know your life. Just be aware that angering an entire pantheon of elvish gods is unlikely to pass without severe consequences. If you're a paladin, your DM might let you use your fine steed spell to summon a Pegasus, but ask nicely and respect the yes or no because ultimately it doesn't really matter. Why? Caster classes gain the fly spell just as paladins receive their first level 2 spell slots, which is a strange way of saying get your caster friend to use fly on your found steed to create a bargain bin Pegasus. The good news is eventually you will get a Pegasus through the fine greater steed spell. Seriously, it's in the text. Of course you might have found something better by then, but hey, later is better than never. Anyways, what do you all think of Pegasi? Let me know in the comments below. A special thank you to my patrons. And thank you all so much for watching. If you enjoyed this video, please hit that subscribe button, smash that like button, share my video on your Twitter, Facebook, or other social media, and make the leap to become one of my patrons on Patreon. I'll see you all next time.